Alléluia. Est-ce qu'on peut acclamer le
Can
Seigneur
we clap unto the Lord one more time?
Alléluia.
Hallelujah.
J'irai là.
I will go right there. Among the angels. Close to Emmanuel to find consolation. I will spend my time praising him, saying to Jesus a great big thank you. One day I will go right there among the angels, close to Emmanuel, to find consolation, spending my time while I wait for the resurrection from the dead, saying to Jesus a great big thank you, thank you, thank you. I will go there. One day, oh beloved, that day is a certainty. It's a promise that is true. That word is certain and it is true. Spending my time, oh beloved, during the wedding feast of the Lamb, in adoration, contemplation of the bridegroom, saying thank you for having accepted me, thank you for having saved me, thank you for having given me the grace to persevere. I will go there among the angels one day I will go close to Emmanuel, and I will spend my time in worship, in contemplation, and it will last 7 years, beloved. Oh, during the wedding supper of the Lamb, I will say thank you for the grace to be here with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, David, Daniel, with Paul, Peter, John. Oh, I will not miss that occasion. I will not miss it. Oh, close to Emmanuel for consolation, spending my time singing praises, saying to Jesus, a great big, thank you for accepting me, thank you for having drawn me to you. Oh, I will go there one day, beloved. It is the hope of the new creation. Close to Emmanuel to find consolation, spending my time in contemplation of my bridegroom, of my beloved, my hero, my savior, my redeemer, my great high priest. One day I will go there among the angels. Beloved, are you enthusiastic as we are? Are you motivated as we are? Oh no, it will not be tomorrow, but it will happen one day. We are in the last days, beloved. It's not for 2020, no, that's not what this song is saying. This song simply says that you must be ready to meet your Creator one day. And I tell you that I will go right there. I will not go to hell by the grace of God. I will go close to Emmanuel, find consolation. He will tell me, well done, good and faithful servant. Spending my time in contemplation of my beloved, of my Savior. I will tell him thank you. I will tell him thank you. I will go. I will go. Oh Lord, open the eyes of my heart. Give me the grace to desire ardently to be at that appointment with the Creator. Give us the grace to be prepared, no matter what the moment when this appointment takes place. Don't let us neglect such greater salvation. I will go there among the angels. I will see the cherubim, the seraphim. I will not be contemplating them, but I will only contemplate the bridegroom, the beloved. Spending my time in glory, in worship, in celebration, telling Jesus a great big thank you. I will go there among the angels. Beloved, this is our hope. My Bible says, rejoice in hope. Seeing that scene, oh, see it and rejoice in advance, and decide to tighten your belt to persevere until the end in obedience. And on that day, you will say, Lord, your grace made it possible. I will go there among the angels. I will go close to my rock, close to my beloved, close to my Savior, close to my Redeemer, spending my time in praises, in thanksgiving, in gratitude, telling Jesus a great thing, thank you, saying to Jesus, a great big thank you. I already say it now, that on that day during the wedding supper of the Lamb, the Bible says when you have access to the kingdom, when you will see Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, you will have the opportunity to sit with the saints of all times. You will recognize them by their face. You won't even need to speak because the spirit of discernment, the Holy Spirit will say, he is Paul, he is Peter, he is James, he is Timothy, he is Titus. How do you know? Well, the Spirit of God will witness to your spirit of who is in front of you. Beloved, you can't live for things that are of this earth. You need to live for eternity. Consciousness of eternity. And my Bible tells me that on that day, there will be many tears and gnashing of teeth. There will be tears and gnashing of teeth. That is on the side of those who would have chosen apostasy. But on the other side, there will be no more tears, no more pain. It will be consolation forevermore. This word is certain. This word is true. This word has been tried. This word was announced. His faithfulness will speak. And on that day, you will say, your grace did it. Your grace helped me. Your grace was my sickle. Your grace strengthened me, made me to hold on firm. Your grace kept me from Satan who wanted to take me over. Your grace kept me. And I will say thank you for your grace. Thank you for your compassion. Thank you for your grace. Telling Jesus a great big thank you. Telling Jesus. Thank you. Telling Jesus. Where you are, beloved, can you lift up your voice and give a great thank you already today because you are in Christ, because you are persevering to this day, because you belong to Him? Can you just lift up your voice and say a great big thank you? I did not merit, deserve sin, salvation rather. He said, you did not choose me. I chose you, established you that you may bear fruit and that your fruit may remain. Thank you for the grace to carry fruit, to love you, the grace to be saved, to obey, even if I fall, the grace to rise again and to continue running towards the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Thank you. Oh, telling Jesus. I can't be silent on this Sunday morning. It's the first day of the week. Thank you for the week that just ended. Thank you because you've kept us in you. If you're connected this morning, it means you still belong to Him. If you're connected this morning, it means He's calling you unto Himself. If you're connected this morning, it means He has a word for you. If you are connected, it means He wants to draw you near to His heart. So lift up your voice and give Jesus a great big thank you. Give to Jesus a great big thank you. Say to Jesus, thank you. I want to tell Jesus a great big thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, oh God, who art holy, holy, holy. Say to Jesus a great big thank you. Oh, where you are, beloved, clap unto him. Clap, 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 clap. Is there someone who is lifting up acclamation? Are you building an altar of thanksgiving? If I'm speaking to you, if you are lifting an altar of thanksgiving, so you know what else you need to say forever, for eternity, for the hope he gave you. I want to say thank you for this hope. Amen, amen. Oh, thank you for my hope. I have an inheritance in Christ. Thank you for the hope. Christ in me, the hope of glory. Amen, amen. Amen, amen. Amen. Oh, let your acclamation go up. Let it go up. Let it go up. Oh, clap unto him. Let your praise arise. Oh, Father, we thank you. We refuse to be greedy in acclamation. We refuse to be Scrooges in acclamation, because we recognize that having two hands is not something you take for granted. There are many who wished they had two just to say thank you. So we do not take for granted what you've given unto us as grace. With these hands, we want to clap unto you to express our gratitude, our gratefulness for who you are, for what you do, for the work you have started, which you will make perfect. You don't do things halfway. You do them wonderfully because of your faithfulness, because your name is wonderful. Excellent is your name. Excellent are your works. We are your workmanship. We are your people. The people, the sheep of your pasture. The people that you lead by your hand. We are grateful to belong to you, to have been washed in the blood of the Lamb. Oh, we are grateful. One day we will go above and we will say thank you. Oh, lift up your praises, beloved. Do something better. ICC at home, do better. Oh Lord, we cannot contain ourselves. We refuse to contain ourselves. The religious hold their peace and contain themselves. Lovers get crazy like David. May God find in you a lover of Jesus this morning. I haven't heard your amen. Lord, I thank you. You are all welcome to our Sunday service at ICC at your home. The Lord is still at work today, and we are so grateful. The fact that we do not meet in person, yes, we miss it. I was telling my wife this morning, we need to keep our good habits, because I really love when, you know, the psalmist said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord, to the house of the Lord. And I love every Sunday coming with my children to the house of the Lord. But don't worry, it's not over. God hasn't said his last word. This virus pandemic will go, and we will join up and celebrate again together, because the quality of the sound system, you know, I like being here because it's not the same at home, amen. But it's okay, we are together. I hope you have a speaker at home to enjoy a live dimension of the service at home, amen. You can't watch the service on your mobile phone, no. You need speakers so that the praise and the bass will sound in your room, for your neighbors to know the Holy Spirit has landed in your house. Amen, amen. Your neighbors need to say, what is happening above? What is happening downstairs at my neighbors? Well, I'm celebrating God. This is the day of my Redeemer. This is the day of the Lord. Allow me to give him a service that is pleasing to him. Forgive me, neighbors, if I do a bit of noise. But there is something right here. The ministry of angels. Angels and men are celebrating the Creator. My prayers are protecting your neighbors. So bless the Lord because of my prayers. The neighborhood is secure because of my prayers. Our families are secure. So bless the Lord with me. Hallelujah. Oh, acclaim him, clap unto him, clap unto the Lord.
Hallelujah. Ah, gloire à Dieu.
Glory be to God. I remember when we were with Pastor Mohamed in a program in Central Africa a few years ago when they said clap, the interpreter would say Maboko Maboko, but there's no word clap to say clap in Lingala or in their language. So Maboko means hands. You need to understand when we say hands, it means just clap, 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 clap. Oh, can someone say amen?
Voilà.
There we are.
Ah, Seigneur, merci.
Lord, we thank you.
Beloved,
before we go into the word today that the Lord has given into his servant's heart, I'd like to tell you that you need to mark on your calendars the Friday 29th of May, Pentecost Friday, we'll have a prayer vigil, the second edition of Answer from Heaven. You don't want to miss that. You really don't want to miss that. Thousands. I don't know how many thousands. Last time there were 23,700 something connections live. You don't want to miss it. This time people were connected from everywhere and they were praying and God visited. Maybe you've not seen it personally, but God visited. Maybe you didn't see the answer for you, but God visited. And as it is written, to pray without ceasing. We will continue to intercede together. That's why you will fill a form that is available online. There is an online form in French with the prayer points from last week, last time, which we added. So you don't need to send individual emails anymore, but you can go to the web link that will be given you. It is in the comments, the description comments of this video. You will see it's also on the page ivancastanu.com. You click on it, you fill the form, and you press send. And we will do the same principle as last time, but we will pray with even more power and fervency in the name of Jesus. Beloved, if you're excited as I am for this program, say amen. So send your prayer points, download the link with put categories and you just need to choose. You just need to give us your name and the city, the country, city where you're connected from, where you're living. Amen. Lord, we thank you for this time, for this day. You have a word for us today. So give us the grace to receive your word. Make your servants able to proclaim, to announce your word with full assurance. And let it be, as this word is being announced, miracles, wonders, signs, deliverances, healings, restorations, reconciliations with God. May the Holy Spirit convince us. May the Holy Spirit convince of sin, justice, and judgment. May the Spirit of life spread forth and give life to that which was dead. May the Spirit of resurrection spread forth and bring back to life what was failing, what was dying. May the spirit of the testimony give somebody a testimony of who Jesus is. May the veil that is stopping the revelation of Christ be torn. And may hearts that are hardened be sweetened. May the hearts of stone become stout hearts of flesh and come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ, the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by him. He is the true God, the Bible says, and eternal life. Holy Spirit, do your ministry. Qualify us. We acknowledge that we are unable. It is a fact. But we beseech you that your capacity this morning should make the difference, and that the food today, the bread for this day, be given to us by you. Make us able, assist us, and make us able to proclaim, and make us able to receive, to digest, and to sit this word at the deepest place in us. Build your church, awaken your church that is victorious, that is glorious, triumphant, conquering, shining without wrinkles or any such thing. Make the difference, because we acknowledge you as being the difference. Make all things beautifully, infinitely above all that we can ever ask, think, or hope for, according to your power that is at work within us. In the name of Jesus the Christ, Father, we have prayed, we have invited you, asked you with thanksgiving. Clap unto the Lord, clap unto the Lord, clap unto the Lord. You can take yours, you can have a seat now in his presence, beloved. May God bless you and may he bless his word. Amen.
Wow.
Wow.
Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Alors ce matin,
so this morning, beloved,
ce matin,
this morning,
le titre de mon message,
the title of my message
s'intitule, comme
is,
vous l'avez déjà
as
vu,
you've already seen,
le titre de mon message,
the title of my message is, in the face of a one world religion, God will respond with an unprecedented global awakening. What my title means is simply that God has no intention to see the devil spread forth apostasy on the earth. God has no apostasy, has no plan, pardon me, to just cross his hands. Amen.
Je n'ai pas entendu
I haven't heard your amen.
Nous avons
we have said that one of the signs announcing the return of Jesus according to the scriptures, one of the signs that announces the return of Jesus will be the multiplication of apostasy, of defection, of desertion, of the abandonment of faith in the church. According to the scriptures, the signs of the return of Jesus in reality must be studied over various angles, with various barometers and with various indicators. When we want to speak of the return of the Lord Jesus Christ in glory, in reality, we have four witnesses that we need to observe. We need to observe the state of nature, we need to observe the state of Israel, we need to observe the state of nations, and we need to observe the state of the church. These four must be observed to measure, to evaluate, examine where we are according to what the Bible calls the parousia, which is the return of the Lord. This return of which we know that it will happen in two waves. Amen. In two stages. Beloved, the return on earth of Jesus Christ, which will be characterized first by the rapture of the church, he will come back in two ways. The first way, he will come back without touching the earth. He will stop in the earth and he will draw his bride unto himself. And I'm telling you, you and I will be part of that in Jesus' name. And the second coming, beloved, when he had come as a slave for the first time, he will come as king of kings, Lord of lords. He will come back in as his majesty, as he truly is. He will not come as a baby in a manger. Forget the baby. That was just for his earthly arrival. He's not a baby. He is his majesty, the eternal true God and eternal life. He is the image of the invisible God, the first one of all creation, for in him, in Jesus, were created all things on earth, above authorities, dominations. Amen. He is not a baby. Religion says, oh baby Jesus, pardon me, baby Jesus, where have you seen the child? Okay, I'll be calm. The return of the Lord Jesus Christ on earth, beloved, is part of the fundamentals of what we call the holy doctrine. This return was taught that all the fathers, all the apostles spoke of his return. And this message concerning his return is simply part of what we call the inheritance. When we speak of his return, we are speaking about the inheritance that God has reserved for future life, for the life to come, for the life after death. Because when we've received Jesus Christ, we have received an inheritance. Amen. We have received an inheritance, except that there are two sides to that inheritance. Part of the inheritance is for life, the present life here, and that part, that current inheritance, is the work accomplished at the cross. What Jesus did at the cross is the inheritance he left to us. He became poor that we may be rich. He was beaten that I may be healed. He was rejected that I may be accepted. He was hurt. He was crucified. His feet were nailed for my feet to find stability, for my life to find solidity, for my life to find expansion. He was nailed in his hands for my hands to have strength, dominion, vigor, for my hands to do the miraculous, for my hands to be diligent and productive. Amen. That is the inheritance of our present life, of the earthly life. There's an inheritance that God has reserved for us in Christ that starts on earth, for earth, and there's an inheritance for eternity. So God did a double inheritance. Right now, I give you, and for eternity, I reserve this. I have already given for you, I have reserved for you. And when we speak of that eternal inheritance, the return of Jesus is part of that inheritance. In it, you have the rapture, you have resurrection from death, you have the wedding of the bride, the land, you have saving from the great tribulation. When we will be saved above, there will be a great tribulation on earth. And then there is the 1,000 years reign. For 1,000 years he will reign as king. And my Bible says in Revelation 5:10, we will reign on earth forever and ever. We shall reign on the earth forever and ever. I don't know for you, but, and it's not all, after the inheritance, after the 1,000 years reign, it's not over. The Bible announces creation of a new heaven and a new earth. Yes. And after the new heaven and the new earth, now what was interrupted by Adam, which is reigning on earth by the children of God, will continue forever. Beloved, when I think of such an agenda, you don't want to miss the program. And by the grace of God, you will not miss it. Give me a better amen. For a long time, we spoke of the inheritance of this present life. And it's normal, it's biblical. But ever since the beginning of the confinement, because the hearts of men are more ready to hear what the Spirit wants to say, the Spirit asks the church to speak about the inheritance to come. Because the manner he does it in order to... The manner in which you will behave on earth will often depend on the vision you have of the future. Yeah. That's why the Spirit is whispering into the hearts of many of his servants so that they will speak to the church of the inheritance to come. It doesn't mean Jesus is coming tomorrow, no. It means that each and every one of us must always be ready to meet their Creator, because you don't know when Jesus will come, and you also don't know when death will meet you. But you must always be ready, because you can't allow yourself to miss the rapture. You cannot afford to miss the first resurrection. You cannot afford to miss God's agenda. That's why you must always be ready and persevere until the end. And by the grace of God, you and I will persevere until the end. If I'm speaking to you, give me a vibrant amen. The Spirit, you know, it's important
Le plus dur, c'est pas de prêcher.
The hardest is not to preach.
Le plus dur,
the hardest is to hear what the Spirit is saying now.
Il m'a dit,
he told
pour
me,
maintenant, là,
for now,
Jésus a dit dans Jean 16,
Jesus said in John 16, 12, I still have many things
maintenant.
To say to you, but you cannot bear them now. There are things
pas.
When the Spirit speaks them,
people
don't listen. But there
quand
are circumstances
arrive,
which when they come, suddenly people listen. That's the
Dieu
way it
parle,
is. God speaks when he knows that
c'est
you're ready to listen. That's when he will send specific foods. And then, in truth, there are some who speak of this theme because they are listening to the Spirit, and some speak of this topic because they hear others speak of it and they feel, oh, this is what we need to speak about now. No problem. The most important is that we speak about this. Amen. Amen.
Et vous savez, la réalité,
and
c'est
you know,
y a
in reality, there are many who do not want you to speak of the signs. Say the signs with me. Many don't want us to speak of the signs of the return of Jesus. Many say that, well, when you speak of the signs of the return of Jesus, you are actually scaring people. But let me tell you that those who are connected to this platform, when they hear this word, fear leaves them. And audacity and faith and assurance come into them. If it is you, say amen. What is funny is that I really ask myself questions. I'm doing a bracket here. I really wonder who is currently playing to try to scare people. Who is trying to scare people, really? In Africa, people are not afraid. But here, they've so told people about fear, corona. They've so forgotten to say that 85% of people go through corona without dying. That it's just a fever and that there are now populations that are more at risk. It is a fact. But because we don't speak of those who survive, fear is spreading even faster than the virus. Even they are saying, at least for Europe, that the virus is not moving as much. But that fear is moving much more. As soon as you sneeze, people get scared. Even young people who don't have health issues, they feel, if it catches me, I will die. Come on. It is fear.
Lorsque vous essayez
when you try
de trouver un sens spirituel
to find a spiritual
pandémie,
sense to a pandemic, such as the current one, when you tell
que
people
permis,
that God allowed, God did not desire, but God allowed it to call the world to order, to call the church to order, to make people to understand that all the things you hold on to are but vanity and pursuit of the wind. Come back to God.
Lorsque vous essayez
when you try
de faire une analyse spirituelle,
to make a spiritual analysis of the pandemics, of the fear that has caught up the earth, many people accuse you of wanting to manipulate, ride on fear, trying to intimidate, to manipulate people. But I repeat again, I wonder who is trying to fill the earth with fear. Because when I hear what WHO is saying, when this professor is saying, epidemic is going down, somebody says this, the same day WHO says you will live with it every day, it will never leave. So please tell me, who is trying to spread fear? Think about it. Think about it. They think that for people not to let go in the application of barrier measures, they are thinking you need to scare people. But you know what? We don't need to be afraid to respect barrier measures. The desire to protect my parents, the desire not to contaminate my mother, is a factor that is sufficiently motivating for me to respect social distancing. I don't need somebody to try and scare me, because today, if you're not scared, they consider you're not normal. They want to scare children, whereas they don't have problems. They want to scare everybody. We don't need to be afraid to respect social distancing. We just need to be motivated. Fear is not a good motivator. But the world today is spreading. There's an influence. There's an invisible influence that is trying to put fear on all human beings. There's a spirit of fear. The spirit showed me that is taking place everywhere on nations. You need to be afraid. When you're not afraid, it's not normal. If you don't say what the WHO is saying, they say be careful.
Si tu ne
if you do not repeat what the WHO is saying, they say, be careful, you are not speaking the same language. What is WHO? The World
Health.
World. Does it say anything to you?
Oh, je vais faire peur aux gens.
We try to scare people.
Si tu ne dis pas ce qu'ils
disent, if you don't say what they are saying, then...
Si
if
tu oses dire,
you dare to say, it may not be a remedy, but if you dare to say that to fight coronavirus better if it attacks you, you should strengthen your immune system. If you speak about that, if you dare speaking about your grandma's remedies, they say careful there. If you dare to say that by taking, by having good eating, by eating well, by taking tea, artemisia, curcuma, tea, turmeric, a bit of garlic, etc. I don't like some. That you should do inhalations. If you are attacked, do inhalations. They'll tell you, oh no, no. So they publish an official notice to say don't listen on internet to those who speak of natural remedies against corona. Wait for the vaccine. And while you wait for the vaccine, well, keep waiting. So they tell us
de ne pas avoir
not to
à l'alimentation naturelle,
look que ce to all natural things, whereas the body comes from the earth, and the earth is meant to heal it rather than chemical products. Think about it. There is a fear that is trying to catch human beings.
Alors moi, je pose une question.
So I ask a question, how were our grandmothers behaving? Everybody heard about grandmothers' remedies. You were not there. Occident, the West, you were not there. When I grew up in Africa, when we had a cold, when we had the flu, our grandmothers would take hot boiling water and they would put vapor rub inside. Last time I tried with one of those balms. And it is so hard if you burn. But when you come out of it, it has cleared your lungs. But the WHO says, no, no, when you cough, medicine. When you have pain somewhere, medicine. Your nose is dripping, medicines. No, there are things for which we can heal without medicines. They are natural remedies. Oh, no, 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 you must allow the pharmaceutical industry to increase. What is not pharmaceutical is a danger. Excuse me. I refuse fear. Now they are sorry to realize that corona hasn't killed as many in Africa as they would have loved. They are really sad about it. But why did it not destroy so much? Because you see, in Africa, they give you many theories. I'll give you some of them are at least honest to say it's because people in Africa, in poverty, their body is so used to being attacked every day. So the body says, ah, you are a new one. Okay, come and try to destroy me. I have confronted malaria, I've confronted Ebola. We fight all sorts of things here. So when a new bacteria comes and says, can I destroy? The body says, ah, we are ready, come. And then corona says, fine, let me go back to the Western world. And even here in the Western world, corona, no effect. You die in the name of Jesus. Amen. What I'm trying to tell you is that there are messages people do not want. They do not want to be heard. But to announce the signs of the return of Jesus is to speak of the holy doctrine. For now, the Spirit has put it to heart, and that's why you're hearing it here and there. It's not an error. And then later, yes, we will come back and speak about the inheritance for our present life. But the truth is, most churches, and it's the truth for us too, we've never taken the time to speak about the inheritance for eternal life. And we speak about it now. Why? Not because it's a good idea, but because the Spirit of God tells us to speak of it now. We cannot but do what He tells us to do. Amen.
Donne-moi amen encore.
Give me an amen again.
Plusieurs se sentent effrayés,
many feel threatened, feel scared rather, when we speak of the signs of the return of Jesus. Some are afraid, oh no, please don't tell me of the signs. The signs, say it with me. It's because they've not understood. The Spirit told me it's because they've not understood that the goal of the signs, what the goal is, he says to tell you, the signs are like, they are like signs, traffic signs. They are signs to indicate things. They are signs that indicate that we are coming close to a city. A sign doesn't have the objective of scaring you. A traffic sign is just there to warn you, so that he who reads the sign will be careful. When you're driving on the road and you have a traffic sign that says there's a radar for 1 kilometer, the goal of that sign is not to scare you, to give you fear of the radar, but the goal of that sign is for you to adjust your driving, your behavior, your speed, so that you are not caught by the camera. Amen. The goal of the sign is not to scare you, it is to warn you so that you readjust yourself. The sign, what is bad, what is wicked, is when we don't put a sign and then the camera catches you, whereas you were not warned there was a camera. That's when it's hard. But when God gives you a sign, when God announces the signs by prophetic words, and you can see the manifestation of those prophecies, it's not mean, it's not to scare you, it is simply to say, let him that reads the sign be careful. I haven't heard your amen. And he told me, the sign is not a message of fear, the sign is a message of love. The sign, the signs are motivated by love to make sure as many as possible do not perish, but that they may come to the knowledge of the truth and that they may be saved. So bless God for the signs that announce, the signs that he gives, that he instructs in your word, in his word, because it's a way to call us to action, to call the church to adjust itself, to prepare itself. You don't have that much time. Adjust yourself. Jesus is coming back. It is certain. He's coming back soon. It is certain. I've not said he's coming back in 2020 or in this decade, but I'm saying he's coming back for sure. And even if he doesn't come back in your time, you will die one day. So my question is, are you ready to meet your God? By his grace, you will be found ready in Jesus' name. If I'm speaking to you, say amen and clap unto God for the certainty of his return. Clap unto the Lord. Glory be to your name, Lord. Can somebody say amen? Beloved, to speak of the signs of the return of Jesus doesn't have the objective to make us build up food stocks, lock ourselves into our homes and hide into play into like what they call the millennials or whatever, I don't know. No, speaking of the signs of the return of Jesus doesn't have the objective, doesn't have as goal to make you give up everything. Thing, saying, I'm not going to school anymore, I'm not studying anymore, I'm not going to get married anymore, I won't look for work because Jesus is coming back. No, when we speak of the signs of his return, we are not telling you to abandon everything and to say he's coming back this year. No, that's not the goal. Continue what you're doing, continue studying, continue planning, continue to have ambition, continue to study, continue deploying yourself and excelling, continue conquering, continue pursuing your vision, but as you are doing it every day, be conscious that he can come back and that you could leave the earth. So always be ready at all times to meet your God. I haven't heard your amen. I said I've not heard your amen. Speaking of the signs of his return is a way to call the church to prepare, to go back to the oil, to communion with the Holy Spirit. It's a call to consecration. It's a call to separation.
Amen.
Amen. Speaking of the signs of his return is for us not to be distracted by the love of the world. By the love of the world, because the pandemics of coronavirus has shown us all that the world has nothing. It is nothing.
Il y a rien.
And truly, there's nothing. It's just a mirage. It's an illusion. Pandemics demonstrated to the world that when Satan told Jesus, "If you bow before me and worship me, I will give you the wealth and the glory of the kingdoms of the earth." Satan told him, "I'll give you money. I'll give you success. I'll give you contracts. If you bow, if you come into our group, our strange group, where we meet and everything is hidden, if you come there, I'll give you this, I'll give you that." That's what he proposed to Jesus. Corona demonstrated that all that Satan is ready to give men, really, he's giving them an illusion, because one little virus, not many, there's not even a combination of Ebola plus this or that. No, just one virus has turned the world upside down. So people are saying, "Satan, you gave me wealth, you gave me power, but I'm locked up in my house. What am I doing with it? And I'm losing everything anyway." It is showing that everything Satan proposes has nothing to it. There is nothing to envy the world, beloved. The only truth, the only realities that endure forever are the things that are from heaven and not the things that are earthly. A virus has taken the world upside down. Let me tell you something. In the kingdom of heaven, there's no virus that will create disorder. In heaven, there is divine order. Where God reigns, the blood of Jesus comes and says, "Hey." And may the blood of Jesus speak in your life. In the name of Jesus, amen. Give me a better amen.
So,
beloved, we've said that one of the signs announcing the return of the Lord Jesus is the multiplication of apostasy. When you read, look at how Paul announces
how
the hearts of men will be in the last days. In 2 Timothy 3, verses 1 to 5. 2 Timothy 3, look at it. When you read the expression, the last days, he's speaking about the times of the end. When we speak of the times of the end, it doesn't mean the end is tomorrow. No, don't worry. Say amen. There are people who are panicking. No, calm down. What matters for God is that you should understand the importance of preparation, of keeping the oil, keeping your fellowship with the Holy Spirit, keeping the word, being careful with your association, not allowing anyone, bad companies, to take you to hell. No, you're holding on to the right people. He who walks with the wise becomes wise. Stay with wise people, with people who fear God, amen, and who obey God. I haven't heard your amen. 2 Timothy 3, 1 to 5, but know this, that in the last days, perilous times will come for men. Now listen to the description of men in the last days. You could think that he's speaking of unbelievers. No, no, look at this. There will be perilous times for men will be lovers of themselves. They will only pray for themselves. Lovers of money. Scrooges. Give your tithe. No. Offering. No. But even those who don't, if you don't give, you must know what you are not giving will be automatically taken by the devourer. So when you give, it is kept by the grace of God, by the faithfulness of God. You will never see a Christian who doesn't give and who prospers. It will not happen. Never. Men will be lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers.
Wow.
Disobedient to parents. Honor, no, I want honor. Unthankful. There will be part of those who forget the good that you do to them. People who forget. They were nothing. You made them by the grace of God. What they've become, what she has become. You helped her. You gave them the hand. You gave them food. You allowed them to get their immigration status. But one day, the way the person speaks to you, you're like, what? Those who forget. Unthankful.
Manque de reconnaissance.
Lack of gratitude. Unholy. Unloving.
Déloyaux.
Unforgiving, disloyal, slanderers. Slanderers comes also from the word diabolos. Do you know that in ICC there are many pastors who did adultery and Pastor Ivan hid everything? Really? Really? Wow. Oh, he must be an apostle of Satan. Really? Wow. And the news travel around. But ask me, I will tell you what is true. No. They don't want to know what is true. They want to spread venom. And I have compassion for those who swallow this venom, who are beaten and infected by that venom. Venom. Slanderers. Without self-control. It means they can't control themselves. They can't hold themselves. They don't know how to manage themselves, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, traitors, so used to knifing people in the back, headstrong, haughty, hard to control, lovers of pleasure, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. And I thought that he was describing pagans, unbelievers, until I see in verse 5 having a form of godliness. So really, he's not talking about unbelievers, he's talking about apostates, having a form of godliness but denying its power. And from such people, turn away. And because it's the word of God, somebody say, amen. So, beloved, in these last few weeks, we have spoken of the tares, the chaff, apostasy in the church, the tares, the chaff, false Christians, those who infiltrate the church, who believe they know God but don't know Him, those who prophesy in the name of God when God has never spoken to them. But today, the Lord told me to tell you that in the last days, in the final days, don't worry. There will not only be the apostate church, because in the field, there's not only tares, in the field, there's also wheat that is growing. I can see the wheat that you are growing, beloved. If I'm speaking to you, give me an amen. Because he told me the church that is apostate cannot bring the world to repentance, because it has not repented itself. It cannot give the world to the unbelievers the desire to know Jesus Christ, because they themselves don't know him and they are not thirsty, they are religious. But God told me, before the return of the Lord, there will be an increase of apostasy. But don't worry, before the return of the Lord, there will be, God will launch, God will cast his net, and there will be a great harvest of souls for eternity like never before. Amen. I haven't heard your amen. He told me that he has no intention to allow Satan deceive the world through apostasy. No, because he is coming back, and when he comes back, Jesus Christ will come back for a church that is glorious, victorious, triumphant, conquering, without wrinkles or any such thing. So when Jesus comes to pick up his bride, the bride he will find will be a bride that is shining, glorious, magnificent. He will come to look for a church that is having dominion. I haven't heard your amen. Ephesians 5, verses 25 to 27. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spots or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. What am I telling you? I'm telling you that before the return, before the rapture of the church, there will be apostasy, yes, but there will also be a presence of the Holy Spirit like never before. Beloved, I don't know which church you've decided to join, but I've come to tell you, if you've come to join the faithful church, wait, because there's a menu that is coming, beloved, which you've not yet seen. That's why this word is prophetic, and it is for the times to come. Can someone say amen? So, I asked him, so what are the characteristics of this church that is glorious? Say with me, glorious church. Say with me, glorious church. What is the glorious church? It's the church that manifests his glory. It is the church that will reveal, that will move the curtain to demonstrate who he is. It's the church that will make him visible. It's the church that will give him the grace to express himself and to demonstrate his facets. It's the church that will reveal to the world agape, his love, his honor, his power, his wisdom, his authority. He is invisible, but he will become manifest through a body called the church. My beloved, I'm trying to tell you that before the times of the end, the world will see the manifestation of a church that is victorious. It will no longer be the depressed church full of depressed people, the church of the fornicators and immorals. No, it will be a holy church, powerful, without wrinkles, pure. He is the one who will do it. He will do it himself. Amen. He told me you will recognize her with a sign. You will recognize her at the fact that the church of these days is a church that will keep the love of God in its heart. God, Jesus said in Matthew 24:12, and because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. Because lawlessness will abound like a gangrene, the love of many will grow cold. But he also told me for the victorious church, the love of the greater number will not grow cold. The love in your heart will not grow cold. Let the apostates do what they want. Let unbelievers do what they want. Let the false prophets do, prophets do and say what they want. But I announce to you, there are people who will be unbreakable. If the fornicators continue, fine. Let false prophets do what they want, fine. But there's a church that will rise and say, I am not impressed. It's not because a pastor or prophet fell that I will fall. It's not because an Elijah or the children or an Eli or his children are doing bad that I will fail. No, there is a people who will make a decision to sanctify themselves and to keep themselves holy. He told me in the church of the last day, this church is a church that will be characterized first by agape. Agape will be found in its heart. Agape will not grow cold. Agape will continue to increase, in their hearts. Why? Because that church will know who they believe. It will not have believed in men of God. It will not have believed in apostles or prophets. It will have believed in Jesus Christ. It will know in whom it has believed. It will know that he has the ability to keep that which it has committed unto him. Let it be your portion in Jesus' name. Give me a better amen. Even if we are less than 10 here, let's make a vibrant amen heard as thunder. That's it. That's it. Glory be to God. He told me, the church of the last days, you will recognize it by its ability to love God. That means to keep his word. It will love the truth. It will love brothers and sisters. It will not criticize. It will not slander brothers and sisters. It's not the church that keeps saying, oh, this one, look at how she's dressed. Oh, she took the guy I was interested in. No. That church will be a church that will be distinguished by its ability to walk in love, brotherly love, will be without hypocrisy. It will be sincere. When we say we are together, we will truly be together. It will not be the church of traitors, of slanderers, of disloyalty. No, it will be a church of men and women who are faithful. Amen. The Lord says in John 13:35, by this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Can someone say amen? The church of the last days will not be overcome by the love of the world, by lust of the flesh and the pride of life, because the church of the last days will be conquered by the love of the Father, filled with the love of the Father. Amen. In Romans 8:35, Paul says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? What will separate us from the love of Christ? I've come to tell you that the church of the last days is a church that will be immunized against offense. It means you speak badly to someone and they will not be like, wow, how you speak speaking to me?
No,
the church I'm telling you about for the months, years to come, I announce to you a generation of men and women, even when you speak badly to them, they are not bothered. They feel you must have some personal problem. They don't take it personal. They are not proud by saying, why are you telling me this? No, I'm telling you of the manifestation of a church that will be immunized against fear, jealousy, against rebellion, that will be a church that is immunized because nothing will separate them from the love of God. Beloved, may God give you the grace to be part of that church. The church of the last days is a church that will reveal salvation of Jesus Christ to the nations. It will bring nations to turn to Jesus. Why? Because of the dimension of love it will operate in, but also because of the dimension of power of resurrection. God told me it's true in the last days, the iniquity will have increased for a fact. Yes, but he told me, but where sin abounds, grace will abound much more. I haven't heard your amen. Romans 5, verse 20. But where sin abounded, grace abounded much more. Where you will see iniquity spreading, God said, no, I will not just cross my arms. No, when iniquity will spread forth, and this is what I started, you will see that my grace will not just spread, it will abound much more. It will not just abound, but grace will over. Abound. It means that in the end, God will release a dimension of grace, a dimension of power, a dimension of the Holy Spirit on the church, without which, when iniquity will be everywhere, if God doesn't pour upon the church a supernatural dimension that has never been seen of grace, of power, of ability, the church, the true church, will not be able to bring nations to come back to him. Why? Because Satan will deploy, he's already deploying a lot of efforts to deceive. So in order to bring back, people must deploy beyond what Satan is deploying. I'm telling you prophetically that this season has already started in Jesus' name, and I pray that this grace will be spread upon you who have connected to the sound of my voice in the name of Jesus. If I'm speaking to you, give me a vibrant amen like thunder. Give me again another amen. He told me that in the last days, he will not cross his arms. No, he will spread forth his spirit in a way that is extraordinary. If he doesn't do it, the church will not be able to impact the world. His salt will not be able to impact the world. His light will not be able to shine. He needs to spread forth a dimension of the Holy Spirit without preceding the, without like never before. I announce to you that there is a coming of the Holy Spirit. It's not yet here. Right now, it's just the beginnings. There's a coming of the Holy Spirit that is coming, which you see in Acts 2, 17 to 21. Because you see, it will be, the sentence starts the same way as the others. He says, and it shall come to pass in the last days. Say with me, in the last days. When the Holy Spirit came down on at Pentecost, Peter and people started speaking in tongues, and they started operating in a dimension of miracles of the supernatural like never before. Peter told them, don't worry, this is the accomplishment of the prophecy of Joel. But let me tell you something. Joel prophesied, Peter identified the prophecy, but in fact, that prophecy that Paul gave 2,000 years ago, it is really for the times of the end. But it started with Pentecost, but it is for the return of the Lord.
Est-ce que quelqu'un me suit?
Is someone following
Dans
me?
Les derniers jours, dit Dieu,
it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. Yes, and on my men servant and on my maid servants, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy. I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the coming. You see, he says, before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. And it shall come to pass that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. I haven't heard an amen. Peter announces that in the last days, before the return of the Lord, God will spread forth a dimension of the Holy Spirit. He says, your sons and daughters shall prophesy. It means he's announcing. We are not yet there, but it's coming. A dimension where the stars will no longer be the prophets. Why? Because all the sons and the daughters will be prophesying. Young people, we have visions. The stars will no longer be the prophets because all the young people also will have visions. Even old men will have dreams, visions. He's telling you of a season where the Holy Spirit will be the only star. Oh, give me a chance to clap onto the Holy Spirit. Give me a chance to clap onto the Holy Spirit. Amen. He is announcing a spreading of the Holy Spirit. He told me,
vous allez opérer à une
you will operate in a dimension.
Vous allez opérer une dimension.
You will operate in a dimension that has never been
Pourquoi?
Seen.
Je
Why? Because
I
will spread forth my spirit.
Amen.
And he said,
the
dimension of the last days will be more glorious than that of the first church. So when you see what the first church experienced, he said, that was the beginning. But Pastor Ivan, what makes you say, whereas the Acts of the Apostles, what we saw the Holy Spirit do was extraordinary. He told me the dimension of the last days will be because apostasy has increased, has abounded, and it will release the outpouring of the Spirit. That is greater than what the first church experienced. Why? Because Haggai 2:9 tells us the glory of this latter temple shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. The dimension of spirit of the last harvest will definitely be greater than that of the beginning. Say amen. I haven't heard your amen.
Ça sera plus grand, bien
it aimé. Will be greater, Dieu beloved.
Tu vois, il m'a dit, hein,
you
ce
see, he
là,
told me, this message
je
is prophetic.
Que j'ai entendu,
I tell you what I heard and I announce it. I announce it. You will see.
Et c'est cette effusion
and
du Saint-Esprit
it is this outpouring of the Holy Spirit that will ensure
vous, il va y avoir une dimension
there will be a dimension of the supernatural, of the miraculous,
qui ne sera pas le fruit
that will not be the fruit
de nos jeunes.
Of our young,
la prière,
of our
oui.
fasts and
Mais ça
prayers.
Pas parce qu'on a
yes,
jeûné 40
our prayers,
jours.
But it will not be
ça
because we fasted 40
coup.
Days.
It, is,
it will be because time is short and God will release His Spirit. You see people who are fighting, struggling with sin, fornication, just as long as their heart keeps thirsty for God, their fights will be ended in a day. There is a grace of not pouring that is coming. The Holy Spirit, no, I need
wait
for the, I need this one for Or the gospel, demons stop troubling him. It will not be because of the pastor, because of his anointing, but it will be because of the anointing of the Holy Spirit and of power that we will pour out on the church. Somebody say amen. It will not be due to the man of God. It's because we are in the last day and we need to redeem the time. And the first one to redeem the time is God himself. He has got no time to lose. Apostasy is spreading round. He needs to redeem the time. He said there are people, you will be set free. There's an outpouring that will come. I'm announcing to you that the church of the last days will experience, if you've seen the resurrection of the dead in the book of Acts of apostles. I'm telling you, you will see the dead rise. I haven't heard your amen. He said everything you saw in the first church will be greater, will be intensified. The church of the last days will be a church where while someone is evangelizing, he's finished evangelizing, he doesn't have a car or what, no problem, he's in Africa, and suddenly the Spirit touches him and he's in Europe. He came in without a passport, he came in without a visa. And somebody say amen.
Acts 8:39.
Now when they came up, that's the story of Philip, when he baptized the Ethiopian eunuch. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught, he kidnapped Philip. He took him away so that the eunuch saw him no more. Put the next verse too. And he went on his way rejoicing. Verse 40. But Philip, he was there, but suddenly he finds himself in Azotus, another city. Beloved, there's going to be, I don't know how you call it, transmutation, how do you call it? I don't know. But from here, you find yourself there. You find yourself in another country, and you just keep on announcing the gospel, and then he takes you back to Africa. Can somebody say amen? Oh, beloved, believe me or decide not to believe me, but I'm telling you that the church of the last day will be a mighty church, beloved. Amen. He told me the church of the last days will be a church that will see an effervescence of the angelic movement. If the apostles experienced it, what will happen in the last days? You see, he said what will qualify men to operate in that dimension is not their fasting, but it will be the love. It will be the love that will be found in them. All that you will be asked of is that agape stays in you. And when I find my love in them, my determination in them, my zeal in them, even if they fall, I will lift them. As long as love is there, as long as love is there, as long as love is there, as long as you did not allow yourself to be carried away, as long as agape is in you, he will use you. I announce a season to you where the superstars will not be the pastors, the apostles. No, everyone will be used of God. He said your young men will have visions. Do you know this dimension has already started? Yes. The Spirit is coming down in different places in the world. The Spirit comes into prayer meeting. I know a child of 13. I think she's 13. While she was speaking, an angel was speaking to her. That girl was not even fully converted, but her parents were in Christ. And the Bible says that when you are in Christ, your children are already set apart for God. God started working with the child. The child comes to church but hasn't really said yes to Jesus. But the child at 13 has dreams where she sees angels speaking to her. One day she saw an angel that told her about a certain man of God that she had never seen. She doesn't know him. She only hears Pastor Ivan and Pastor Mohammed at home. She didn't know that man of God. An angel told her, all those who call themselves men of God are not all men of God. Many that say that they are my servants are not serving me. And the angel showed her a picture, the picture of a prophet that people call prophets.
Elle se lève le matin.
She got up in the morning.
Et la voix lui dit,
and the voice told her, that man is not of me.
Il est Adam
He's
et Steve.
Adam and Steve.
Hein? What? Il est Adam Steve.
He's Adam Steve.
Tu as compris, non?
You know what, voilà. I mean, right? Okay.
Chaque alamos. Parce que maintenant, on risque de supprimer les messages avec l'intelligence artificielle. Il y a des mots qui disent on retire le message.
If you say some words, they will remove the message. But we found a way to go around this, right? Adam Steve.
Elle se lève le matin, elle dit à sa maman.
She got up in the morning, she told her, Mommy, I had this dream. I had this vision. An angel told me this and that. And one day her father went to church, takes them to church, to another church. And when they get to that other church, the girl sees there was a conference. She sees in that church special speakers of the conference, this man of God. She said, Mommy, that's the man I saw. That's the man. That's the one the angel said not to listen to. I don't want to come to this church. Mommy, let's go. Let's go, I don't want to come here.
C'est la mère qui
and
nous a
it is the mother who
moi.
Told us the story to my wife and I.
Elle n'a enfant,
a child, enfant. A child.
Elle avait conversation avec les anges.
She had a she had conversations with angels. In the last days, I will pour out my spirit. May God pour out His spirit on our children.
Que les jeunes gens,
may
que
young men, may sons and daughters of ICC prophesy in the name of Jesus. May our old men have dreams and dreams and visions. May the outpouring of the Holy Spirit be poured out and be noticed from now, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. If I'm speaking to you, give me an amen as thunder.
Oh. Je suis en train de t'annoncer que l'église des derniers jours sera une église de miracles, de prodiges, de signes, une église de miracles, of wonders, of signs,
but a church of the supernatural. What you saw in the Acts of the Apostles, look at Acts 5.
On les arrête.
They were arrested, they were taken to prison. Acts 5, 17 to 19, then the high priest rose up and all those who were with him, I'll pass a bit of the text, the Bible says, and they laid hands on the apostles and put them on the common prison. But at night, an angel of the Lord opened the prison doors and brought them out.
Okay, maintenant on va au verset
now we
22,
go to verse 22 and 23.
Arrivés,
but when the officers came and did not find them in the prison, they returned and reported, saying, indeed, we have found the prison shut, listen, shut securely. And the guards were standing outside before the doors. But when we opened them, we found no one inside. So what happened? The Bible tells us that an angel came in and opened the doors to the prison at night and brought them out. And this is where the Spirit told me, look at the text. The angel did not turn them to ghosts. No, they did not become invisible. They did not become spirits to come out of the prison. They came out physically out of the prison. So what happened? What happened, in fact, is that the guards were before the door, but the angel, the guards had eyes, but the angels deactivated their sight. They had ears, but the angel deactivated their hearing. They had eyes but could not see. They had ears but could not hear the footsteps. They couldn't hear the doors open. Why? Because God is able to deactivate the five senses of just anyone. It is a dimension where we will operate. People will come looking for you to harm you. They will look for you even physically to harm you. And when they arrive, you are seated before you, before them, and they look. They are looking for you whilst you are there. Let it be the dimension we operate in this decade, in the name of Jesus. I haven't heard your amen. There are people who will be locked up in prisons. He told me he will bring them out and ask them to continue announcing the good news of the kingdom of God, and nobody will understand. It will be a wonder, a miracle. Church, I announce to you that the church of the last days will not be there to suffer. It will not be a church that is overcome. Amen. I announce to you that the church of the last days, he says he will raise authorities. He said everything you saw in the Old Testament was a shadow of the things to come. You saw Elijah, you saw Elisha, you saw people when they speak, fire falls from heaven. When they speak, they can close the sky, they can open the sky. When they speak, fire comes down. There are people that will raise. When they speak, a fire not physical will fall to consume satanic armies. Armies of demons will be destroyed by a word from their mouth. People that will raise, who will speak and command the sun, command clouds. You will see that creation will obey the sound of their voice. What you saw in the Old Testament was but a shadow of the things to come. It will come to pass before the return of Jesus. I announce to you the manifestation that is imminent of a church that is glorious, victorious, triumphant, of a church that is conquering, of a church that is shining. Beloved, if I'm speaking to you, give me a living amen. Ascender.
Clap unto him.
And he told me, I'm coming to the end. Do not joke. God has no intention of observing Satan as a spectator. Oh, he's turning souls away. No, no, no. God says where sin abounded, look, you will see what we call the greater abundance of my grace. My grace will save you. My grace will qualify you. My grace will put an end to fights you have had to fight to this day. I will pour out a dimension of the Holy Spirit. Some people used to say, well, I desire to do this, but there's a strong man of masturbation, of immorality that has been holding me. He said, just wait. When this season becomes manifest, there are fights that will stop automatically. Keep love. Keep perseverance in prayer. Keep love.
Tu le verras.
And you will see it. You will see it. You will see it manifest. You will see it. He told me the church of the last days is a church, yes, that will be persecuted. It is a fact. It will be persecuted. But why will it be persecuted? Because you need to understand something. Suffering and persecution are friends of the miraculous and of the supernatural. There cannot be supernatural without persecution, because persecution has many virtues. Persecution unifies Christians. Persecution makes sure that there's no me, because when we are all targeted together, we need to be together, come together, amen. I haven't heard your amen. The church of the last days will be a church that is persecuted.
But
there's nothing new under the heavens, my friend. There's nothing new under the sun. When you read 2 Corinthians 4, verses 8 to 10, 2 Corinthians 4, 8 to 10 in the Living Bible, he says, we are pressed on every side by troubles, but not crushed and broken. We are perplexed, but we don't know why things happen as they do, but we don't give up and quit. Sometimes we say, what did I just escape? But we don't give up. We are hunted down, but God never abandons us. We get knocked down. Yes, we are on the floor, but we get up again and keep going. These bodies of ours are constantly facing death, just as Jesus did, so that it is clear that all that it is only the living Christ within us who keeps us safe. So it is all about our ability to rejoice in tribulation. He said they will fight you. They will fight you, but they will not overcome you, because I am with you to deliver you, amen. I haven't heard your amen. The church of the last days is a church that will be persecuted. It is a fact, but it is a church that will not just take it easily. No, it will fight back, and it will cause turnarounds by its ability to pray with persistence. With persistence, when the devil will feel he has hit it, the church will lift its voice. It will create a corridor of prayer that will make sure the God of justice comes down in the affairs of men and turns situations in their favor. I'll tell you, persecution hasn't started today. Aman persecuted Esther. Amen. That was persecution. But the persecution they suffered, rather Mordecai and Esther and the Jew people were persecuted by Aman. He used the best he could, but that persecution did not stop God from making his glory to shine and from causing a total turnaround in favor of his people and in his inheritance. Amen. The church of the last days will not be an overcome church. It will be a conquering church. By prayer, the grace will be spread upon it through prayer. Look at what happened in the Acts. When you read Acts chapter 12, verses 2, 7, when you read verse 2, Acts 12, verse 2, it is written that Herod, the king,
killed
James,
le frère de Jean,
the brother of John, with the sword. The next day, he makes them arrest Peter. He wants to kill him also. by the sword. And now the church gets angry and says, touch not my servant, touch not our pastor, touch not our apostle, touch not our shepherd, touch not the church. Got angry, decided to lift prayers to God night and day for many days. Are you following me? Amen. And what happened? What happened in verse 7, in verse 7 in the text, you see that when the church prayed, an angel came into the prison.
An angel,
no, not verse 23, verse 7, an angel came to the prison where Peter was. An angel brought him out. The Bible tells us that Peter was being kept. He was being kept by four groups of four soldiers, 16 soldiers for one man, 16 soldiers to keep one man. The angel came in and paralyzed them. Even he didn't just, before I thought that God just hits people with blindness. No, I discovered that God doesn't just make you blind. He can make you blind, deaf, mute. He blocks all your five senses. And they didn't see Peter come out. The great door opened. They heard nothing. Oh, can somebody say amen? It's the dimension where the church of the last days will operate. And when I speak of the church, I'm not speaking of a building. I'm speaking of a people, beloved. It's the dimension we will operate in Jesus' name. Amen. But because of their intercession, yes, it's true, they were hit, James was killed, but the church prayed, and when the church prayed, now when we go to verse 23, in the same chapter, so it's the continuation of the same story, the king Herod, the king that was untouchable, he was the almighty king Herod, the Bible says, one day as he was making a speech, at the same time, because he became so proud, the Bible says, immediately an angel of the Lord struck him, because he did not give glory to God and he was eaten by worms and died. It's not because he hadn't given glory, no, because he caused the innocent, the righteous, the untouchable. He had killed him and the judgment of God found him a while later. I'm telling you that the church of the last days will not be a church that is undergoing always. No, even if it is persecuted because of its prayers, the God of justice will erupt in the affairs of men and he will give to each man according to his word. He will beat some, he will humiliate others. Those who fought his people will be humiliated by the just judge in Jesus' name. Herod was hit for touching James. But in verse 24, the Bible tells us, but the word of God grew and multiplied, and the number of the disciples increased. It means that in spite of what Herod did, the kingdom kept increasing. When James had gone to rest from his work, the reign of God was prospering, deploying, increasing by the assistance of the Holy Spirit. We spoke about the tares before. Today he said to tell you about the wheat. Amen. In other words, by this word, I have announced to you that in the last days, in the season we are in, in the decade we are in, I've come to announce to you a revival, a global awakening unprecedented. It will be experienced not by a group of men of God, but by a people of God. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. I will pour out my spirit. I cannot just have a couple of men of God who are superstars. No, I need my entire army to bring souls back to myself, to fill my house. I cast out my net to bring home the souls. It's the dimension in which the church will operate in the last days. I repeat, this word is prophetic. So he told me to finish with Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 2.
Écris.
Then the Lord answered to me and said, write the vision, make it plain on tablets, that he may run who reads it, that it may be read. Put it on the tables of your heart. Say, this day Pastor Ivan announced in 2020, on the 17th of May. Write that down. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it will speak and it will not lie. Though it tarries, wait for it, because it will surely come, it will not tarry. The church of the last days will not be overcome. It will be a church of dominion. It will be a church that will reveal the wisdom of God to the world. It will be the church which, yes, will suffer persecution. Mordecai was persecuted, but you will see after the persecution, you will see lifting of people like Mordecai, like Esther, who in the midst of persecution, God lifted them. And they had dominion in their generation, in their days. And the Bible says that many unbelievers became Jews because of Mordecai. There will be a great harvest of souls. There are people who will operate in spheres of influence, economics, politics, media, culture, entertainment, education. They will operate with a wisdom that is supernatural. Of course, they will be hated, but hated that we will have for them will not stop them from being lifted by God and from having dominion in the midst of their enemies and of their adversaries. It's the menu, it's the agenda I'm announcing you for this decade. So permit me to tell you, my brother, my sister, welcome to the decade of domination in the name of Jesus to Christ.
Shakata ramama ele ko ramadea reseta ramama ele kamarabo kinamare shalemaya lemaro sakadama adreta torobobobza libera doro sekera mama shibele karamate ramara sele maramarama shere maro shele mama. Oh, Église, est-ce que tu es prêt?
Oh, church, are you ready to operate in this dimension? Oh, beloved, I have introduced you to the menu God has for you. Victorious church, triumphant church, glorious church. God has an army that is rising to obey Him. God has an army. God has an army. That is rising to serve Him. God has an army in His church that is rising, a glorious church. God has an army. Lord, strengthen, prepare our hearts. Keep the love of God. Keep your heart more than everything. You will be qualified by your heart, not by your fasting, not by your title. It is your heart that will qualify you. I will use people who have kept love in their heart, people who have been immunized against offense, rejection, wounds. Grace is coming. I will pour out my spirit. God has an army. The church that is victorious is getting ready. The glorious church. God has an army. God has an army that is rising. God has an army. God has an army that is rising. God has an army that is rising to serve Him. People of God, lift up your hands to worship Him. Are you a candidate? Are you a candidate for the glorious church? Are you a candidate to manifest His glory, to reveal Him, reveal His love, reveal reveal his honor. He will be honored to reveal his honor. You will be powerful to reveal his power. You will be unstoppable to reveal his authority. You will be greatly filled with supernatural wisdom to reveal the infinitely great wisdom of God in your days, in your generation. Church, yes, there will be an apostate church, but I announce to you that there will be the overabundance of grace that will birth a church that is glorious. God has an army. So people of God, lift your hands. People of God, lift your hands to worship him. People of God, God will speak, prophesy, he will announce, he will raise, he will call multitudes. So people of God, lift your hands to worship him. People of God, open your mouth. He will prophesy. He will speak for you. I announce to you a time. God will speak. God will speak. God will speak. Yes, beloved. The Holy Spirit. There will be, the stars will not be just a few. No. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Confirm this word, Father, from now on, from now on, from now on. Confirm that word. God will speak. God will speak. God will speak. Lift up your voice, lift up your voice. Give thanks to God, beloved. Ask God for the grace to be qualified. Ask God for the grace to keep your heart. Ask God the grace to be part of this church that is glorious. The bride, she will not be suffering. She will not be submitting to pain. Persecution doesn't just mean that we are hit and nothing changes. No, Mordecai was persecuted, but he was lifted. Many multitudes will be persecuted, but they will be lifted in the middle of their brethren, in the middle of their enemies, their adversaries. Persecution will not stop your royalty from being manifest. Persecution didn't stop Joseph from reaching the throne. He was persecuted by his brothers, by the wife of Potiphar. That didn't stop him from becoming prime minister. That was his experience. Whatever the persecution, yes, he will go through persecution, but persecution will allow Christ to live in you. So death acts in you, but life acts in you to spread through you. Father, manifest this word. Raise men and women who will have dominion over sin, who will triumph over the world, over the flesh, over the devil, who put their flesh down, who put hell down, people before whom dominations, authorities can do nothing. They will war against us, but they will not overcome us, because you are with us to save us, to deliver us, to keep us, and to make us able to accomplish the will of God in our generation, the plans of God. So speak, accomplish your plans, manifest yourself in the face of the apostate church. Raise the church that walks in life, in love, in signs, that is unbreakable, that is unbeatable, unstoppable. Before, in the face of apostasy, manifest the victorious, the glorious church that reveals you in the name of Jesus. Pour out your spirit, pour out your spirit, pour out your spirit. God will speak. God will speak. God will speak. Are you clapping unto the Lord where you are? Are you clapping in front of your keyboard? Are you clapping in front of your screen even if you are not commenting? Clap us. This word is certain, it is true, and it's totally worthy of being received. This word is prophetic. It will come to pass. It has already started. For now we see only the beginning. For now we only see it as a cloud. But announce you, but the rain is coming. For now the church is in the dimension of the cloud. God hasn't given his last word concerning you, concerning me. Your life will change, your destiny will count. You will be manifested. He will manifest this church that closes the mouth of the devil, that church that will cause the enemy to flee. He will leave our neighborhood, leave our region. The devil will leave our countries. He will leave us alone. And all those who are destined for eternal life will come home. They will come back home. They will come back to the Father in the name of Jesus. The will, the plans of God will come to pass. He will triumph in the name of Jesus. May God give you the grace to love the truth, to hide his word in your heart. May God give you the grace to be found sealed with agape. And therefore, you will be a vessel that is qualified to operate in this dimension where the Holy Spirit will be out, we will be poured out like never before. Amen. Oh, beloved, clap, appreciate, give him all the glory, give him all the glory by clapping unto him. Are you clapping where you are? This word is for you, beloved. You will not live in a life whose presence is as insignificant as its absence. The salt that you are will impact, the light that you are will shine. You started small, yes, you were under the table for long, I agree, but I announce to you, but God will pour out a dimension of Holy Spirit and power that will make sure no strong man, no cemetery, no tomb, no family altar will be able to keep your inheritance, your marriage, your finances, your shining. You come out of the tomb, you come out of the tomb. You will not be held back any longer. You will not be stopped any longer. I see that grace upon the church, poured upon the church, only if you decide to be part of those who will rise. Is there somebody who wants to lift up their acclamations and celebrations? Beloved, the Lord has described to you, given to you the agenda before you. So don't look in fear, don't look left and right, don't listen to the world, don't listen to TV, don't receive fear. He's told you about what is coming for you. If only you keep your heart, you will be qualified. I said you will be qualified. Your heart is the battlefield. Make sure you're not taken away. In the face of the apostate church, we are not impressed. God, there is the tares, but God will allow the wheat also to grow. Your destiny will be manifest. In the face of this outpouring of the Holy Spirit, there are people who have been fighting for a long time. We've prayed deliverance over deliverance, over deliverance, over deliverance, over deliverance. It is not that God doesn't exist.
Ce n'est pas qu'il n'y a pas l'onction.
It is not that there is no anointing.
C'est juste que
it is simply that
diffusion.
There's a level of outpouring, there's a level of grace.
Quand il est répandu,
when it comes down,
les combats de plusieurs années,
the fights of many years,
ans,
the fights of 12 years, the fights of 18 years
jour.
Will stop in a day.
À toi juste de t'assurer.
So your role is to make sure you join the church. That is glorious.
Et de décider.
And that you decide
de le révéler.
To reveal him.
De serrer sa part.
To hide his word in your heart.
Alors, bien aimé, avant de conclure,
so beloved, before I conclude this message, this service,
je lance un appel à toi.
I send you a call.
Dans quelle catégorie es-tu?
In which category are you? Are you in the church that is apostate?
Celle qui sera disqualifiée.
She who will be rejeté. Disqualified, rejected because she rejected him. Him, or are you in the church, or do you decide to join the glorious church? She who will allow agape to triumph over her. The glorious church is conquered by love. There's no space for wounds. You spoke badly to me, you slandered against me. No, we just forgive and we move on. We are no longer taken down. There's only one who fills our heart. It is the Holy Spirit. There's only one deposit in our heart. It is agape love. May God cause you to enter and dwell in the glorious church in Jesus' name. There's no more space for fear in this church. In the heart of these people, there is no more place for jealousy. We rejoice with those who rejoice. Do you want to enter that dimension? You must start by the beginning. Entering the church is not going to church on Sunday. It's not connecting to the service on Sunday. It is deciding to make Jesus Christ your Lord and personal Savior. It means you invite Jesus and you don't stop there, but you walk with Jesus. You will be misunderstood, fought. People will point to you with the finger. You'll be persecuted, but that's why you need to hold on to Christ. And we, ICC family, are here to persevere with you, to hold you by the hand. If you lose a family, don't worry, you will find a new one. It's called the spiritual family, the family of God. But I beseech you, don't leave this service saying, well, I heard a nice message. And by remaining apostate, unbelieving, with one foot in and one foot out.
Because
you don't know when you will meet your
Creator.
You don't know what will happen to you next or tomorrow. What matters is this very moment. Tomorrow is but a hope. Later on is also a hope. It is not a certainty. So choose to confess and to receive Jesus now. So do you want, you who are connected to the sound of my voice, who was invited today and have not yet given your life to Jesus, even if it's just one person, the Bible says there's joy in heaven when one sinner repents. Bow your head with me. I'm speaking to you, the prodigal son who went away. I speak to you, you are the lost sheep. You were in the house and you backslid or you became apostate. You want to come back. Bow your head and pray this prayer with me. With a loud voice, say, Lord Jesus, I ask you to forgive me for my sins, my misery, my disobedience. This morning, I want to come back to you. I want to be part of this church that is glorious, without wrinkles, without spots, that cannot be reproached. I beseech you, spread forth your spirit. Spread forth your grace. Make me able to be that person that you want me to be. Enter me. Wash me by your precious blood. Change my life and give me the grace to walk in newness of life. From today, I recognize you, Jesus Christ, alone, no one else, as my way, my truth, my life, my Savior, and my Lord. From today, I will call upon no other but you. Jesus Christ, in the name of Jesus, I have prayed with thanksgiving. Amen. Amen. Can you now clap unto Jesus? Can you clap unto the Father? I said, can you clap now where you are, beloved? Clap. To clap is not just to beat your hands. It is to shout with your mouth. It is to clap with your hands. It is to dance and celebrate. Because there is joy in heaven when one sinner repents. So listen to me, beloved. If you did not know the Lord, you made this prayer for the first time today, I ask you, there's a number that will come on screen. There may also be a barcode that will appear, a QR code. It should be there, really. You will send the word salvation to the number on your screen. You will receive a form and I ask you to kindly complete.